Hey guys, it's Monday, February 22nd. I just got home from my first cardiac lecture, and let me just say that it's making me question why I do this to myself and why August isn't tomorrow. It was the longest lecture of my life. I found myself putting my head down on the desk like 4 times. I know I should have been paying attention, but it was just so boring and so draining. I'm exhausted just from sitting there all day. And this is the first time in my video I think I've had to whip out my handy dandy notebook to tell you guys what we talked about, because we pretty much went over like the AMP part of the heart again in the beginning, and we didn't really have to write it down. She just wanted us to know the structure of the heart again, and that took about an hour. And after that, when we started getting into like the juicy details of cardiac, yeah, she lost like the whole class because we were all just exhausted, and it was just so much. We all ended up just looking like robots writing everything down. I can't even tell you what I learned today because I was just scribbling and writing so much. So I'll go through and just list a couple key points that I wrote down while she was talking. And the worst thing about it is the PowerPoint she went with isn't up on our school website where we can access like study materials. This is one that she particularly made, so we had the right material instead of the one that goes along with our textbook. So we pretty much just had to scribble what we could while she was going through it. And this is all I got. Tomorrow, we're going to go through the rest of the chapters, which is 18, 20, and 21. So we talked about arteries. We talked about how if you have an MI, which is a myocardial infarction, aka heart attack, or any kind of angina, which is chest pain, your arteries are going to be involved. Heart disease is the leading cause of death for women because we're more affected. We talked about veins, how they carry blood from the capillaries to the heart. It's deoxygenated and it keeps patency, and the valves carry blood flow against gravity. Capillaries carry the blood from the arteries to the venules, from networks in most tissues. The walls are one cell thick to promote the gas exchange. RBCs, red blood cells, carry oxygen. Platelets help clot formation. And WBCs, white blood cells, obviously you monitor those for infection. So we talked about unavoidable things that put you at risk for heart disease, which is your age, sex, race, ethnic origin, environment in which you grew up in early childhood, whether you live in like a rural or suburban area, the city, whatever. Hereditary. Things you can't control is things you can control to prevent heart disease is if you're obese, your lack of exercise, if you smoke, stop. If you don't pick up the habit. Hypertension, elevated blood lipids, and alcohol. You're supposed to limit men 2 drinks per day, women 1 drink a day. Yeah, I'm a nursing student. Do you really think we go by that? So we talked about LDLs, which is your bad cholesterol. It always needs to be less than 100. HDLs is your good cholesterol, greater than 50 in women, and greater than 40 in men. And you don't want to give any kind of beta blockers or heart medications with grapefruit juice because that can increase the serum levels. And statin drugs like Crestor can cause liver failure. That's why you want them to stay on the regimen and not take too many or up the dose without asking or consulting the doctor. We talked about cardiotonics, how they slowly strengthen the heartbeat. If your heart rate is less than 60, you want to hold and take the apical pulse. If it's less than 100, you definitely want to hold the drug and contact the HCP immediately. We talked about digoxin toxicity. And signs of that is anorexia, nausea, vision changes, things are looking yellow. And you always want to check their potassium level and check their apical pulse before administering digoxin. It can be given PO or IV. We talked about antiarrhythmics, which is amiodarone. It's a beta blocker. And it helps restore rhythmic movements of the heart to normal. It slows your heart rate and lowers blood pressure, so you always want to check that before you administer those drugs. Diuretics are going to increase the water and sodium loss, and it helps control edema, which is fluid retention. Lasix is the most potent loop diuretic. You want to monitor their potassium levels. Anticoags treat abnormal clot formation, and you want to watch for signs of bleeding. We talked about heparin, Lovenox. Those are IV or sub-Q. You don't aspirate or massage the Erixtria, some kind of drug like that. She was talking so fast. Coumadin. You have to be on it for 3 days for it to become therapeutic and start working and really thinning out your blood. We talked a little bit about Eliquis, not too much. Heparin. You're going to give protamine sulfate to prevent hemorrhage in the event that that happens. And for heparin, you're going to check the APTT and the PTT. You're going to keep a close eye on their platelet count. Coumadin is the PTINR. 3 days become therapeutic. And we learned that Coumadin is actually made of rat poisoning, which is very interesting. She told us a story on that, how one farmer put rat poisoning out to kill the rats on his farm, and his cows were eating the poison, and they ended up dying because they were bleeding from the inside. And they figured, hey, if it can thin the blood in cows, why can't it thin the blood in people with heart disease and heart issues? So, bam, that's how you got Coumadin. Xarelto is a factor 10. Plavix, it's similar to aspirin, but it's more potent. It's an antiplatelet. You want to watch for bleeding. And you want to assess for any current respiratory infections or allergies, and usually it's given post-MI or stents surgery. We talked about nitroglycerin. You're going to give 3 tablets within a 15-minute period. It's sublingual. Do not chew or swallow the tablet. Always just put it under the tongue and let it dissolve. You should feel a fizzling or tingling sensation. If they don't feel it, it's not working. Calcium channel blockers dilate the coronary arteries and helps improve oxygenation. Sorry, it's been a long day. It's going to increase the flow of blood. You're going to check BP and heart rate before giving. Vasopressors, beta blockers, they're going to decrease heart rate and blood pressure. So you're always going to check if the systolic blood pressure is less than 100 or if the heart rate is less than 50, you hold the drug. You do not give it. Oxygen therapy is going to supply oxygen to the cardiac muscles and try to help transport blood. We talked about assessment of cardiac chest pain, location, character, severity, onset and duration, aggravating and alleviating factors, associated symptoms, and treatments that the patient sought and if they got an effect from it, if it made it worse, if it helped. The PQRST pain assessment is what provokes, the quality radiates, severity, time, and then you're going to assess each area that they're talking about. Pitting edema is documented with a +1 through +4, depending on how deep the crater is. When you press the extremity, there's a jet. That's how you note it. And there was a chart in our book. We looked at it for like 2 seconds and then we kept moving. And when you assess turgor for like dehydration, you don't check the hand, especially on the elderly, because their skin loses elasticity. And she told us that you could check it on the forehead, the clavicle, thigh, abdomen, or forearm. Do not check the turgor on the hand. So your capillary refill should be less than 3 seconds. When you check the apical pulse, you write down the rate number, the rhythm, if it's regular or irregular. If you hear a swishing sound when you're assessing the heart sounds, that usually indicates that there's a heart murmur. Then we went into diagnostic tests and labs. Complete blood count, white blood cell count, which is what you're going to look at to assess for infection. Blood coagulation factors are going to be up during and after a heart attack. And your cholesterol level should be 200, no more. Your HDLs should be greater than 50, less than 40 for men. And your LDLs is less than 100. We started talking about the electrocardiogram. Non-invasive, the patient needs to lay still, breathe normally, and no talking. The Holter monitor You can wear it for 24 hours and the patient can resume normal activities. It just monitors the heart, and then you go to the cardiologist and they'll take it off and read what the wave said. We talked about the echocardiogram, the stress test. That's when you run on the treadmill with a blood pressure cuff and a heart monitor hooked up to you. 1 to 2 hours before that test, you're allowed to eat a light meal. And by light, she said, like apple juice and Jell-O. Because anything can affect your test results. You definitely want to stay away from caffeine, alcohol, and nicotine. Then we start talking about cardiac catheterization. That is a sterile procedure. That's when it's inserted into the heart and around the surrounding vessels to see where the blockage is. You're going to assess for allergies to seafood, iodine, or radiopaque dyes. Withhold solid foods 6 to 8 hours and liquids 4 hours to prevent vomiting and aspiration. And you're going to monitor the vital signs, monitor for chest pain, and monitor the peripheral pulses, and notify the MD if your patient complains of chest pain when they come out from that procedure, or numbness and tingling in the extremities. Therapeutic management. We talked about a PTCA, which is a percutaneous transluminal coronary angioplasty, which is one or more arteries are dilated with a balloon catheter to open vessels to improve arterial blood flow. And they're going to be maintained NPO after midnight before the procedure. You're going to wash the groin area and shave as needed. You're going to assess baseline vitals and peripheral pulses before and after surgery. If there's no peripheral pulses in certain places you check before surgery, there could be a clot. Post-procedure, monitor the vital signs, distal pulses, maintain bed rest. Keep the limbs straight 6 to 8 hours if they go up through the groin area or wherever they go. Whatever area, whatever limb is affected, you keep it straight. You do not move it. It is on bed rest. Coronary artery stent is used instead of the PTCA. It's a balloon catheter-bearing stent inserted into the coronary artery and positioned at the site of occlusion. When placed in coronary artery, the stent reopens the blocked artery. After the procedure, acute thrombosis is a major concern. The patient will be placed on anticoags and antiplatelets. And the last thing we talked about before she finally released us was the arthrectomy, which removes plaque from the artery by using a cutting chamber on an inserted catheter used to improve the blood flow to ischemic limbs, mainly seen in patients with peripheral artery disease. And post-procedure, you're going to monitor for embolus and stenosis. So tomorrow, she said, we're going to continue where we left off and start talking about angioplasties. We're going to watch a video about angioplasties and all kinds of good stuff. We don't start clinical until next week. We have 8 total clinical rotations. 4 will be in acute cardiac unit in the hospital, and the other 4 will be at the long-term unit in a nursing home. So cardiac is not going to be as exciting as I thought, because it's a lot of work and a lot of mind power and willpower to try and learn all this. And the heart is definitely, obviously, the most important functioning organ of the body besides your brain. And I understand that it's very important, but that's a lot of information to cover in one sitting. And I didn't even go over everything that I wrote down because I didn't want to talk forever and I didn't want my video to be like 4 hours long. But yeah, in 8 hours, by the 3rd hour, she lost like the whole class. Like, we were all just like, oh my gosh, is this for real? And no one is excited about cardiac anymore, because we were at first. And now that we see what we've gotten into, it's like, no. But we have class tomorrow, 8 to 4:30. We're off on Wednesday. I picked up a shift at work. Thursday, we have class 8 to 4:30, and I'm off Friday, and I work the weekend. So, I hope you guys have a great Monday. It's been a long one. I'm getting ready to go to the gym, and then I'm coming home and going to sleep. Today is Tuesday, the 23rd. I just got home from lecture. We basically went over CHF, congestive heart failure, and the differences between the symptoms of left-sided and right-sided. If it's left-sided, you're going to have more pulmonary issues like dyspnea and a cough, and you're going to produce frothy sputum. And if it's right-sided, you're going to have more symptomatic systems like the ascites and fluid retention, aka edema. and oliguria. So we talked about that, and we talked about the different types of anginas, however you want to pronounce it, tomato, tomato. And we went over DIG toxicity again. If you administer 3 nitros within the 15-minute period and the symptoms of your patient are relieved, obviously you're going to notify the doctor and call the MRT immediately if you're working in a hospital. And then we went to the computer lab and we practiced some NCLEX questions. They weren't hard, but like with every practice NCLEX test, every answer seems like the right answer, so you have to like debate in your head back and forth, and it was just really frustrating. But we're off tomorrow, we have class on Thursday, and we're off the weekend, so hopefully we learn a little bit more on Thursday. We didn't really do too much today. It wasn't that bad of a day. I really thoroughly enjoyed learning about heart failure, though, because my father has been diagnosed with CHF. I don't know if his is left or right-sided. I don't know how extensive his heart failure is, but yeah. I was really into it when we learned about that because it's, you know, it hits close to home. So I hope you guys enjoy your Tuesday, and I'll hopefully make a video at the end of the day on Thursday. Hey guys, today is Friday the 26th, I think it is. I forgot to make an entry yesterday when I left school. We had a very busy day yesterday, and I have to keep referring to my notebook because of all the notes we take during her lecture. So yesterday we finished talking a little bit more about heart failure, we went over DIG toxicity, and we also talked about valvular disease, which occurs when the heart valves cannot fully open, which is stenosis, and then if they push the blood flow back the opposite way, that's regurgitation. And then we talked about cardiomyopathy, which occurs when the heart is enlarged and weak. Certain things can cause it, like chemo, alcohol abuse, pregnancy, poor nutrition, hypertension, and autoimmune issues. There's 3 types of cardiomyopathy: dilated, hypertrophic, and restrictive. Restrictive is when the ventricles are stiffened. The hypertrophic is the increased growth of the left ventricle muscle, and the hypertrophic is extensive enlargement of the ventricles. So we talked about that, and we talked about ejection fracture. Usually people with heart failure, their heart works at about 40% instead of the full 70. And then after we talked about the cardiomyopathy, we talked about pericarditis, which is inflammation of the pericardium. Thickening of the pericardium, and it constricts the heart. The sac is inflamed. We talked about myocarditis, which is inflammation of the myocardium, the heart. Endocarditis, which is the inflammation of the inner lining of the heart and valves, and it occurs in patients with IV drug abuse, valve replacements, and a mitral valve prolapse. We also talked about cardiac tamponade. I just see the word tampon in it and I try not to laugh. I know that's very immature. Pericardial effusion, accumulation of fluid in the pericardial cavity. It decreases the cardiac output and restricts ventricular filling and cardiac output drops. We talked about pulsus paradoxus. When people take a deep breath, their BP plummets. Then we started talking about rheumatic heart disease, which is an inflammatory disease of the connecting tissue, especially in the cardiac valves, usually caused by beta hemolytic streptococcus, scarring of the heart valves. Then we started talking about the cardiovascular meds like the anticoags, heparin, warfarin, thrombolytic medications that prevents, obviously, blood clots, antiplatelets, the contraindications for those medications. You don't want to give it to people that have increased risk of bleeding, like that have ulcers. Let me see. And then we talked about cardiac glycosides. 0.5 to 2.0 is the normal range. If the apical is less than 60, you always hold it. And if their potassium levels are less than 3.5, hold the drugs as well. We talked about beta blockers, how they lower BP and lower the heart rate, so that's why it's important to check their heart rate and blood pressure before you administer any beta blocker. And for CHF, if they lose weight, they have decreased edema, increased energy, and normal heart rate and BP with the normal parameters. That is an improvement of their CHF. It's not worsening. So that's pretty much all we went over. And then after we did that lecture, we went to lunch for about 30 minutes. Then we came back and went to the lab. In the lab, we learned to administer EKGs. And when you put the nodes on somebody, I took a picture because she finally wrote it on the board for us. The first node is going to go V1, which is the fourth intercostal space, the right sternal border. So it's going to be here. And then the V2 is the fourth intercostal space to the left. So it's going to be like, they're going to be kind of, they're even in the right above the sternum. And then the V3 is halfway between V2 and V4. V4 is the fifth intercostal space at the midclavicular line, so pretty much on the heart. And then the V5 is the anterior auxiliary line on the horizon V4, which is going to be kind of over a little bit. And then the V6 is going to be like right under the auxiliary, the armpit. And on the legs, you put them kind of on the shin off to the side where their line would run to their pedal pulse. And then on their arms, you put them at about right here, and they'll be about even on both arms. So we did that. We hooked up the machines with the connectors. Our machines were out of paper, so we couldn't really print out the results, but we did learn how to hook them up. And then after that, we did the fun stuff. We did IV therapy. We learned to take the catheter, flush it, put the catheter in the arm, and then tape it all up, make sure it's there, and then we also learned to discontinue it and take it out. And then after that, the really fun part was drawing blood on each other. I have a small little dot from where they tried to draw my blood yesterday and they couldn't get my vein. So they went fishing a little bit. It didn't hurt, it just kind of felt weird and I didn't like it. But you have to learn, and learning on each other was a really good experience. But yeah, we did phlebotomy on each other after we did the IV therapy. I really like running the IV therapy. I like setting them up, and I like hanging the bags. Last clinical, I mentioned in my video that I did my first PICC line IV antibiotic therapy, and that was amazing. That was so fun. I loved it. So that might be something I look into. I don't know, but I hope you guys have a great Friday, and I will make my new entry on Monday. Monday is our first clinical. We did get our clinical rotation this week, coming up, Monday, Wednesday, and then the Monday, Wednesday after that, I will be at the long-term skilled facility, pretty much the nursing home, and then the last four rotations, we will be in the cardiac unit, because starting this week, the other group is going to be in the hospital first, so we just have to rotate out. I'm really excited to go into the cardiac unit. So it's Tuesday, March 1st. Happy March, everybody. I didn't make a video yesterday after clinical because I was exhausted and I had to study for my test today, which I didn't do very well on. And today in class, it was just a very long, draining lecture. So I'll talk about what we did today. This is our new Bible. We started studying EKG, how to read the slips that come out of the machine and all the rhythms and all that good stuff. And I took a lot of notes. It was just a lot of information in one sitting, and it's just a lot. Like, and yesterday wasn't a very good day. The jets are very active and they're flying like crazy, so I apologize, like always. Today we just went over the conduction system, the SA node, AV node, bundle of His, the bundle branches, which also branch off into the left and right, and then Purkinje fibers. We talked about what the nodes do, what the bundle of His does, what the bundle branches and Purkinje fibers do. We talked about polarization, depolarization, and repolarization. Polarization is when your heart kind of takes a cat nap. It's like completely resting, and then it's supposed to bounce back and depolarize, which is, when it starts contracting and having more electrical flow. And then repolarization, the cells recharge and your heart is just working again. So if you don't come back from polarization, you're dead. You have no heartbeat. And then we talked about P wave. When you see the P wave, it's a little hump in the heart rate thing, that means you have a sinus rhythm, you have a regular heartbeat. And then we learned how to read the QRS, which is the R is your heart rate. And then in the little slip, the sheet that you get, however many heart rates there are, the R waves, you can count those and then times it by 10, and that's your heart rate. So if there's four times 10 is 40. So your heart rate is 40 and they're bradycardic. So yeah, we pretty much went over that. The PR interval, you want it to be 0.12 to 0.20. If it's greater than 0.20, there's a block. And we went over the three functions of an EKG: input, signal processing, and output. And the other two functions is to record voltage and time. Voltage goes on the vertical, time is along the horizontal. And then each red box, the big red boxes, is 0.20 seconds, and then the little ones are 0.04 seconds. And the paper speed is 25 millimeters per second, I believe. And then we talked about the EKG leads. There's three types of leads: standard leads, augmented leads, and precordial. Or precordial, however you want to pronounce it. The standard leads is the 1, 2, 3, and that also makes the triangle. I forgot the guy's name it's named after, but there's a triangle for the right arm, left arm, left leg. That makes the triangle. And then augmented leads, the machine creates those. Those all start with A's, so the AVR, AVL, AVF. And then the precordial leads, V1 through V6. I kind of tried to make my diagram, but I have to redo it because the armpit was way too high. But the V6 goes kind of right under the auxiliary area. EKG prep, you want to know their patient name, their patient ID number, their age, race, sex. Some places make you put their weight and height on there as well. And you want to make sure that they have dry skin, not moist. If it is moist, you need to use like an alcohol swab to kind of dry up that area, or else the nodes won't stick to it. Special considerations: you want to avoid any kind of bony prominences, scar tissue, breast tissue, the heart apex, and muscle mass. If someone's having a seizure or an MI, obviously you're not going to administer the EKG test. And then telemetry: no leads go on the arms or legs. The white is to the right. The black is up on the left. The brown goes in the center. And then you have green and red. Yeah. We didn't really talk much about that. And then we started just reviewing what we kind of went over in class, because she realizes it's a lot at one time to go over. We just did chapters 1 through 4 in this book today, and then we're going to go over 5, 6, 9, and 10 on Thursday. And then we're going to do a little test review. So, I mean, overall it was a decent day in class. It wasn't hard or anything. It's just sitting there for 7 hours for lecture is really hard. As far as clinical yesterday, I didn't even bother making a video because I was really upset that our clinical instructor isn't very approachable. She has a bad attitude. She's not positive or upbeat, and she kind of just brought everybody down first thing in the morning by belittling us because we're LPNs and not RNs, I guess, on her level. Which kind of made me start thinking, like, why would you have RNs teach LPNs that don't even want to be around us? Like, we're part of the healthcare team too. Like, we have a role. Like, we're important. Don't belittle us and make us feel like we're nothing. We're paying a lot of money to become healthcare professionals, and you're being very unprofessional. I constantly had to hold my tongue and be like, don't snap. It's not worth it. You don't want to get kicked out of the program. But it was just frustrating. Like, if you don't want to be here, don't be here. There's plenty of other people out there with master's degrees and bachelor's that would love to come and be on the floor with us and actually teach us, instead of just sit behind a desk and watch us work the floor because the CNAs disappeared and we were doing pretty much CNA work all day. And it upset me because last mod, I felt like a nurse. I was given heparin shots, testosterone shots, insulin, giving breathing treatments, doing wound care, and now I'm right back to doing what I do every day at work, which is changing briefs, showering and bed bathing people, transferring people, making an occupied bed, making an unoccupied bed. Not that there's anything wrong with that. That is like the standard basics of nursing, but I got so excited last mod because I actually started feeling like a nurse, and now I feel like I'm right back to my level of just being a CNA. And I feel like our teacher could be, or our instructor could be, more approachable and more hands-on. She didn't really even talk to us much. There was another instructor there that's learning because she's new, and she was more involved with us than our own instructor. So, and she was really nice. She was more approachable, and she would explain to us, like, some people got notes written on their nursing notes that we had to write, and she would explain, like, well, next time just write it like this, or don't put this in there, or put this in there and write it this way. Like, she was more approachable and more nice about things as opposed to our actual instructor that was listed onto our schedule. The rumor is that we have her tomorrow, and then next week we have the lady that was training and then another lady because she's going wherever or doing whatever. So that's a good thing, because negativity really just brings everybody down. Attitude is everything. I try to look at everything positively. I'm a very optimistic person. I always try to look on the bright side of things. And then first thing yesterday, as soon as she opened her mouth, negativity. And I was just like, first of all, it's Monday. Second of all, it's not even 7 a.m. Third of all, I'm here to learn and you're already belittling me. Like, I don't have time for this. Everybody in my group was just in a bad mood after that. So, like the optimistic person I am, I'm hoping tomorrow will be better. And I'm hoping it'll go by quick. I'm getting ready to do like 20 drug cards on my patient. I gotta do pathos. And I also have to do a concept map with 3 NANDAs and nursing interventions. So, I have a busy night ahead of me. I hope tomorrow is a better day. It is what it is. So, it's Wednesday, March 2nd. I just got home from clinical. It's almost 2:30. We got out a little early today. We were really busting butt on the floor today to get in and get out. Basically, this morning, we went in, we got our patient's vitals, and then we reported them off to our instructor, and then we pulled meds for the first morning med pass, and we all had to bring our drug cards so that we knew what drugs we were giving and why. And I knew my drugs for my patient pretty well, especially Keppra, because I'm on Keppra. So as soon as she asked me why does she take Keppra, I was like, seizures, because I'm on that medication now too. She's on a smaller dose than me, and it could be like a generic brand because her pill was blue and mine is like a big red horse pill. So yeah, I have to like cut it in half for me to take it. But yeah, clinical today went by really smoothly and went really well. Monday, she said we're going to have 2 patients. We're going to be doing showers, and I'm not sure if we're going to be passing meds, but whatever. Each day I wake up and go, it's just one day closer to graduation, and that's all I really care about. It's getting down to the nitty gritty. We're considered seniors now, so we should pretty much know our stuff in and out. There's a couple things we run into, like a little bump in the road where we've never heard of something before, we've never dealt with something before, but for the most part, everyone in class is just there to help us, like help each other. We all have the same goal. We all want to graduate, pass NCLEX, and work as LPN and just go from there. So overall, today was a pretty good hump day. Tomorrow I have class 8 to 4:30, and then I'm off the weekend. I'm supposed to be going to like a petting farm with my mom. I'm excited, but tomorrow's the last day of class for the week. I'm off Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, so I'm very excited about that. I plan on catching up on rest and just studying and going over everything for cardiac for the final, even though that's a couple weeks away. But this has definitely been the most challenging mod since the program has started. And I just really want to pass and just keep moving, because if I fail, I know yesterday I was really depressed, but you know, if I fail, it happens. I might sit out, because you have to wait until they have a spot for you. So I might sit out and go back, and then I might not. I might just find another program to go to, but I've made it this far. I just want to continue and just graduate in August. Like, that's all I want for myself. I'm very excited that I'm this close. Everyone's very excited. And I just hope that Monday's clinical goes smooth like today, even though it probably won't, because we're going to have 2 patients and showers and meds and whatever else we're gonna do. But today was overall a good day, and tomorrow after class, hopefully I'll have the energy after that long lingering lecture to make a vlog. Hello everyone, it's Tuesday, March 8th. I forgot to vlog yesterday after clinical and last week on Thursday after class. And to be completely honest with you, I was off Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, so I completely forgot what we did on Thursday. If it crosses my mind, I'll mention it. Yesterday at clinical, we had two patients and we also had to do showers. And the reason we had to do showers is because on Wednesday, my teacher walked in at the wrong moment and thought that me and the girl I was helping couldn't transfer a patient properly to the shower chair and give a shower, so she assumed we didn't know what we were doing and we should be back in 101, which wasn't the case at all. So we had to do showers, everyone did, and then we had two patients each, and we had all of that knocked out by like 9:30 in the morning, so we were kind of just sitting there like, so what do you want us to do now? And I like having two patients because being a CNA, I'm used to taking care of multiple people at one time and always running around. So I'd rather be busy on my feet than just sitting around writing a nurse's note, kind of wondering like, hey, what should we do? Can we do anything? And basically after we got them up, we went on break at 10, came back at 10:45, did peri rounds before lunch. We went to lunch at 12, came back, did post-conference. It was a really easy day yesterday. And then today we started to talk about IV therapy. We also took our EKG test today. I did a lot better than I thought I did. I thought I completely bombed it, but I got an 80. I'm still kind of nervous though because I have a 74 in the class. And a lot of people have low grade like that. And it's mainly because she says everything is important. And everything that she says is important is what we study, and then it's not even on the test. It's something completely different, so we're kind of screwed. And it's kind of frustrating. But we, basically on our test, we had to be able to label the different 6-second strips of the EKG read. So AFib comes naturally to me. I'm like, oh, that's AFib. I'm pretty good at any sinus bradycardia, sinus tachycardia. And I know the flutter, the atrial flutter, and obviously normal sinus rhythm, but I'm always having trouble with the PAC and PVC strip reads. That to me is just, and ventricular tachycardia, I'm really good at pointing that one out because it's just like big mountains. Those ones are easy, but the PAC and PVC ones completely throw me off every time, and it's annoying. And we also had a sinus dysrhythmia strip on there as well, and I got that one. Overall, I didn't really miss too many questions. It's just because the questions were valued at so many points apiece. I got an 80, and obviously there were multiple choice questions like, what speed is the EKG machine set at? And that's 25 like millimeters per second or something like that. And then the little squares equals 0.04 seconds, stuff like that. The multiple choice wasn't hard. It was reading the strips. That's where I have issues. But then we started talking about IV therapy after the test. We did go over whatever questions people had problems with. And basically today we talked about keeping peripheral patency, central line patency. When you're removing a PICC line, have the patient bear down like they're having a bowel movement or hold their breath. And if they can't really hold their breath, just tell them to hum. And humming, basically you automatically hold your breath while you're doing that. So when you're pulling it out, make sure you keep a steady, continuous pace. Don't pull it out like inch by inch or slowly, because a person can only hold their breath but for so long. So you want to get it out as quickly as possible, but also as safely as possible, because PICC line, you can always get an air emboli. That's like the biggest, most cautious thing that could happen when removing a PICC line, so you don't want that to happen. And also, when you hang IV bags, it's important to change the bag out as soon as it's empty, because when there's just nothing in it and it's sitting there, that can also promote the formation of air emboli getting into their bloodstream, and that can be potentially fatal. So we don't want that. That's really all we started talking about today. We didn't get really too in-depth into it because the test took up the whole first part of the class. And then we went over it a little bit, and then we went to lunch, and then when we came back, we only had like 3 hours of lecture left. So we just started that chapter, and we talked about the pre-procedure. Before you insert any kind of central line or IV, you want to tell the patient what's going on. You want to ask if they have any allergies to latex, even though most places are offering latex-free IV kits and gloves and all that because of so many allergens. And you have to have a doctor's order to discontinue any type of IV or discontinue any IV medication that goes into that IV. And that's pretty much it. That's all we really talked about today. I'm really trying to bring my grade up because I don't want to fail. I don't want this to put me back. And I don't want to have to wait until May for the next class because there's no classes behind us because the next term starts in May. So it's March. What am I going to do for like a month and a half? I don't want to do that. So hopefully I can bring my grade up from a 74 to at least an 80. If I pass a class with an 80, I pass. And this is the hardest class that we've had so far. I'm learning a lot, but it's also very stressful, and it's a lot of information at one time. Hey guys, it's Wednesday, March 9th. Sorry I look like crap. It was really nice out today, so I decided to go outside and do some things. So yeah, I don't look the best right now. But today was our last day for our clinical rotation at the long-term care facility. And basically, I was team leader along with another classmate, and we basically just made sure that our other classmates had taken their vitals. We were responsible for taking temperature and O2 sats on everybody's patient, and then they had to do the BP, pulse, and respirations on theirs. And we had to make sure that all of the vital signs were within normal limits, and anything that was abnormal, we had to report off to the nurse on the cart and then reassess. But basically, I just helped give a couple of bed baths and, you know, give showers to people who need showers. I helped transfer people. I helped feed. Team leader, like the purpose for the instructor that assigned it, basically you don't do anything. You just make sure that your classmates are doing what they're supposed to be doing. And that's not the role I want because I'm so hands-on. Like today, I checked the temperature and the O2 stats with my fellow classmate, and then after that I just jumped right into patient care with my classmates because, you know, some of them don't work as CNAs, so they're still kind of, you know, sketchy about what they're doing. They're nervous to transfer, or they don't really have bed bath down even though they should. So helping people, you know, that's what nursing is. You're there to help someone get better and be there for their well-being, so why not help them out? And that's what I did. I don't really care how anybody else felt about it because that's the type of person I am. I'm going to help you regardless. So team leader really isn't for me. I'm not about it. I would rather be on the floor doing patient care. So we just did ADLs and then we went to break for lunch. And then we did peri rounds after lunch when we came back. And then we got to flush a Foley catheter. It was a 16 French. The urine was not tea colored, but it was very dark, and they wanted us to flush it to make sure there was no blockage or clotting, and we were shown how to flush it with the syringe full of water, and then some extra urine came flowing down the tube, and it was still kind of a brownish color, and that's pretty much all we did today. She wished us well because we're going to start our clinical rotation in the cardiac unit at the hospital on Monday. I think I told you guys I got an 80 on the EKG test that we just took. That brought my grade up from a 74 to a 76. So we're kind of at midterm. There's still a little bit of hope that I can bring my grade up, hopefully, to an 80 because we have to take a IV therapy Kaplan. There's only 30 questions on it. That's 20% of our grade. That's next week. And then we have a case study due. We still have to take our IV therapy test and then our hematology test. So hopefully I have enough time to bring my grades up because I really want to pass and just move on to OB and peds because everyone that's ahead of us that tells us they're an OB, they love it. So with that being said, I hope you guys have a great Wednesday and I'll vlog hopefully tomorrow after class. Hey guys, it's Friday, March 11th. I forgot to vlog yesterday after class, so that's why I'm doing it today. Basically, we left off with more IV therapy stuff. We started talking about infiltration, phlebitis, infection, clotting, catheter embolus, pulmonary embolisms, air embolisms. So basically, infiltration is just leakage of the infused fluid into the surrounding tissues caused by the needle or catheter being displaced out of the vein. So they'll have blanching, cold skin, swelling, or puffiness at the site, or a burning sensation. And necrosis or sloughing can occur with toxic drugs like pushing potassium, chemo, dopamine, vancomycin, or phenergan. Phlebitis is inflammation of the vein wall. They're going to have redness at the site, warmth, tenderness, and draining at the site that's purulent. Infection is basically microbial contamination due to not using aseptic technique. They'll have redness, swelling, warmth, tenderness, drainage, and fever. That's the difference between phlebitis and infection. And infiltration is the fever. Clotting, that's when the clot forms at the back, blocking the end of the catheter. You won't be able to easily push the fluid. There'll be tenderness, and there will also be a sluggish flow. Never forcefully push fluids. If you're getting resistance, obviously there is something wrong. So don't ever forcefully push. We also talked about local allergic reactions. So they'll obviously have redness, hives, itching, and discomfort. We talked about circulatory overload, which is when the patient receives excess amounts of IV fluid. They'll have tachycardia, dyspnea, orthopnea, tachypnea, agitation, elevated BP, crackles, JVD, and elevated CVP. You're obviously going to monitor their INOs. Everything that goes in must come out. Progenic reaction due to septicemia or bacteremia is caused by contaminated IV equipment. Signs and symptoms of that is going to be fever and chills, flush face, tachycardia, headache, backache, nausea and vomiting, hypotension, and cyanosis. Pulmonary embolism is the obstruction by a clot or particle. It prevents blood oxygenation. They'll be tachycardic. They'll have dyspnea, chest pain, hemoptysis, restlessness, hypotension, cyanotic. Air embolism, that's when air gets into the pulmonary artery. They'll have poor pallor, cyanosis, dyspnea, a cough, tachycardia, and shock. That's why it's important, like when you're pulling out a central line, you want them to bear down and hold their breath or hum, because they'll technically be holding their breath. Because if they breathe in air when you're taking that line out, air can go into their bloodstream and cause an air emboli. Catheter embolus, that's when catheter fragment breaks off, and they'll have discomfort, hypotension, cyanosis, thuddy pulse, and respiratory distress. And then we started talking about electrolytes, and she said it was very important to know that thirst mechanism is in the hypothalamus, sense and promote the intake of fluid when needed, and the last sign of dehydration in elderly is thirst. So if an elderly person comes up to you and they're like, I'm extremely thirsty, I'm so thirsty, I need water, that means that they're dehydrated, and that's like their very last symptom. Because since their taste buds and everything is diminished, they don't think that they need to be replenished with fluid as much as they do. That's why it's important to offer them fluid all the time. We also talked about diffusion, filtration, and osmosis. Diffusion is the process in which the substances move from an area of low concentration, from high to low, like Lasix. And then filtration is the movement of water and solutes through a semi-permeable membrane. Osmosis is water that moves by osmosis. That's basically what she told us to know for the test. We talked about sodium. The normal range is 135 to 145. You can have hyponatremia, hypernatremia. Potassium's normal range is 3.5 to 5.5. You can have hypokalemia, hyperkalemia. Calcium, the normal range is 8.4 to 10.6. And like the others, you can have hypocalcemia and hypercalcemia. Magnesium, the normal range is 1.3 to 2.1. You can have hypomagnesia, magnesiema, and hypermagnesiema. And then we basically just reviewed what was going to be on the test. We have to know the three goals of IV fluids, the types of fluids, pH ranges. Calories means dextrose, because we also went over hypo, hyper, and isotonic solutions. So, like, Hypertonic is dextrose, which are calories. So if you have dextrose 10%, 1% of dextrose has 34 calories in it. So you'll just take the 34 times the 10% of dextrose, and then you get 340 calories. So that's like a sandwich. That's what is given to people that are on like TPN, total parenteral nutrition. And the hypotonic solutions has less osmotic pressure than plasma. And that's like half strength normal saline. And then isotonic fluids, that's like your plasma and normal saline and lactated Ringer solution. And we just basically reviewed what colloids and crystalloids were, the nursing responsibility, the five rights when you're administering medication through IV, which is the right patient, right med, right dose, right route, right time. And then checking the med administration, you want to check the med as it is removed from it. You want to check the MAR, and then you want to check the med before actually giving it to the patient. But that's basically all we reviewed. We reviewed everything that we've been talking about this whole chapter. She told us you don't want to mix Dilantin because it crystallizes. Dilantin is a seizure medication. It'll crystallize in the tubing and actually cause like little crystals, so don't ever push that. And basically, IV therapy, it's pretty much just common sense. Like, you always want to keep your equipment clean because it's going into their veins. So, obviously, anything that is not used with aseptic technique is going to go into their bloodstream. So, it's very vital that you clean your equipment and make sure that everything is fresh out of the package and not dropped on the floor and then picked back up and given to that person, because, obviously, that's how infection is going to travel into their bloodstream. But that's basically all we do. We have a test on Tuesday. We start clinical at the hospital in the cardiac unit on Monday, so everyone's really excited about that. And hopefully I can bring my grade up. I'm still sitting at a 76. I got a 90 on our quiz yesterday. I was hoping that would bump me a little bit, but it didn't. I will be very discouraged and upset if I fail this mod because I want to go to OB so bad. But whatever happens, happens. What's up, guys? It is Monday, March 14th. I literally just got home from clinical, jumped in the shower, and got out because I'm exhausted. We weren't doing a lot of hard work or anything today. It was just running back and forth between all these rooms trying to get stuff done. I can say for sure that the hospital obviously is way better than the nursing home. There's so much more to do, and it's more nursing skilled wise instead of like CNA based. Basically this morning we took vital signs. We did ADLs with patients that would let us. We're used to doing everything for the patient, like bed bathing or showering, changing, giving them their clothes and dressing them, brief changes, peri ointment, all of that. At the hospital, mostly all of these people could do for themselves. It was very rare that we had to change a brief today, so we're not used to that. We really felt spoiled, but that's what you get when you go to the hospital. So, basically this morning after we were assigned our patient, we took their vital signs, we did their ADLs, and then we were on the floor, wound care changes. One of my classmates got to discontinue a NG tube, so we all went in there to watch that. Doing it in person is completely different than doing it on the mannequin at school, if I must say. I didn't get to do it, so I don't know how it felt, but she told me it was kind of like a little bit of resistance trying to pull it out. It was harder than it would be on a mannequin, and you just kind of have that dooming fear that the end of the tube is going to come out and just get all of those gastric juices and everything all over the place, so she really had a grip on it. But that went in the biohazard bag, and then we put this, I don't know what it was called, but you put it inside the contents in the little plastic container that catches all of it, and it solidifies it so that it's not liquid, like, just gushing all around in the biohazard bag. It makes it really thick and hard to come out. I can't remember what it's called, but it was kind of like not a powdery substance, but it was harder than a powder. But you just dump it in it, and then it hardens and solidifies it, so that was pretty cool. And then I administered another heparin shot. I love giving heparin shots. My favorite part is when you, after administering it, you push the plunger as hard as you can. The safety comes flying up over the needle. That's my favorite part. I loved it. But my patient was very pleasant. there were sutures from a tumor being removed, and that's about it. You know, A&O times four, great spirits, great personality. And then basically we just ran around and helped everybody. She showed us, our instructor showed us how to use the medication room to get their medications out. Everything at this hospital is so technical, and it's amazing because, you know, the younger generations, we're used to technology. We're technology-based. That's what we love. And to see how it's evolved and how easy it is to not mess up, like, medication errors because of programs like what the hospital has, it's amazing. But today was very productive. I plan on taking a quick nap, and then I'm going to get up and start studying for my IV therapy test that I have tomorrow. Hopefully I pass. I also have 50 Saunders questions due for IV therapy. So that's like an easy 100 if I really try hard and study and do everything for those. I'm just trying to pass the class. As you all know, I'm sitting at 76.97. And I really want to pass and go on to OB. So, by the grace of the nursing gods, please help me tomorrow pass this test. I'm going to study my brains off. Hey guys, it's Tuesday, March 15th. I just got home from class. It's only 1:30. Basically, after our lunch break, she was just going to take us to the computer lab to create tests to study for Kaplan on Thursday. So I figured I can do that at my house and remediate by myself at my house. This morning we took our IV therapy test, and I'm kind of upset about it because I got a 79, and I studied all of my notes last night that I took. I even looked in the book, everything she told us to highlight, star, box, you know this for the test, it's going to be important. So I studied all that material and retained it like a sponge like I normally do, and it wasn't on the test, which is very upsetting. I did really well on the math part. There were 7 math questions, and I only got 2 wrong. And then for, like, the IV therapy things you need to know, I only missed a couple of questions, and most of it was because it was stuff she never talked about, or I thought it was one thing, and then I second-guessed and then put another answer. So after the test, we started talking about blood and, like, blood components. We talked about fresh frozen plasma. We talked about A-positive, B-positive, O-negative blood. O-negative blood is the universal donor. Anybody can get it. AB-positive is the universal recipient. They can take any blood. And that's basically all we really talked about. We talked about how it's important when you are giving a blood infusion, you want to use an 18-gauge needle. For older adults, if they have, like, fragile skin, you can use 22-gauge. But that's basically all we went over. After we went over those blood types, we basically jumped right into Kaplan stuff. So, that's pretty much it. I'm really upset about my test. I don't know if I'm going to pass or fail this class, and that's really bothering me. I'm trying not to think about it, but of course I'm thinking about it. My test average with the 3 tests, the first one was a 75, I got an 80 on the second, and then this one's a 79. That brings my test average to a 78. I have a 76.94 in the class. I don't know how to calculate my grades like everybody else does. So I don't know if that's going to bring me up, bring me down, keep me the same, whatever. I'm like kind of stuck in a rock in a hard place. Like I want to try hard and try and pass, but at the same time I've lost all motivation and I'm kind of just like, I probably failed, so what's the point? And I hate being that way because that's the way I was the first time. And that's why I took a break. But it's also, like, I would have graduated this month if I wouldn't have taken a break. And I know that if I fail this mod, I'm going to have to sit out until another day class opens up, which is, like, in May. I'm not going to want to go back if I take another break. And I've come this far. And it's not that I don't get the material. It's just, it confuses everybody when she says, study this because it'll be on the test, and then it's not on the test. But whatever. We have hospital clinical tomorrow. Hopefully it'll be a good day. And then Thursday we have our Kaplan test in the morning. And then after that, the rest of the afternoon, we're going to be presenting our case studies on our cardiac patients. My patient had CHF, so I just did a simple case study on CHF. I think I've done one before on that disorder. But I'm just burnt out. We have 159 days left if I passed. And it's just to the point now where it's like, I just want to be done with this. When I'm done with school, I never want to hear the word Kaplan or Saunders again. Like, that's legit. I don't ever want to hear those words again. I'm really tired. I'm going to take a nap for like an hour, hour and a half, and then I'm going to wake up, hopefully, and have the motivation to study for Kaplan, and hopefully I'll pass it. But Kaplan's worth 20% of our grade, so if I ace it on Thursday, it'll probably bring me up those 2 or 3 points I need to pass the class. But if I fail it, I'm doomed, and I don't want to redo this unit because this is the hardest mod that we've had the whole program, and I don't have the energy. I'm exhausted. I really am truly exhausted. Hey y'all, it is Wednesday, March 16th. I literally just got in the door from clinical, and the hospital is just so much better than the long-term facilities that we go to. There's just so much more to do. Our clinical instructor is very adamant about finding things for us to do. So basically, when the floor that we're on gets ordered for any kind of blood testing or straight cath or IV discontinuation or running an IV, changing IV tubing, she grabs it and tells the nurses, like, hey, my students are going to do this. As soon as she sees one of us, she points at us and she's like, you, come here, we're going to change this IV tubing. You, come here, we're going to discontinue this IV. Come here, we're going to go push these meds. So she's very hands-on, and I love her. Today, for the first time ever, I inserted a catheter into a male. And unfortunately, because there was clotting and blockage in his bladder, we later found out because when we flushed, a bunch of blood and parts of the clot were coming out, I had to remove it. And the actual nurse that was staffed on that floor got a new catheter kit, and she ended up inserting it and putting it in, because it was very resistant going in, and I didn't want to force it. We're always taught not to force things that aren't just willingly going, so I told my instructor, you know, let's just get the nurse to do it, and she was like, yeah, let's do that, because I don't want to be liable for anything, and you know, stuff like that. So yeah, clinical was very productive. I did that. We obviously gave medicine. We hung a bunch of IV push medications. Vancomycin is like the most common one. And we did vital signs. We took our lunch break. We went to the morgue. The hospital we're at, theirs is only big enough to keep 3 bodies at a time. The security guard that was down there said the longest he's seen a body stay is 1 week. If they get overbooked with dead people, they'll call the funeral home that they've partnered up with, and they'll keep the bodies until the families can come or whatever they need them for. They'll store the bodies until they need to be buried. But that's about it. I'm getting ready to hit the shower and start studying for Kaplan tomorrow. I know I talked about, I think I mentioned it, I took our IV therapy test and I got a 79. And I was scared it would bring my grade down or not move it. It actually brought my grade from a 76 to a 77. So I'm 3 points away from an 80 and just passing the class. Hopefully I pass Kaplan tomorrow, and hopefully I pass the final next week. But things are looking better. I'm feeling positive. I'm really hoping I can really work hard and get these 3 points to boost myself over the passing ledge, because I really want to move on to OB and just continue towards August and graduate and just be done, pass NCLEX and start working. Hey guys, it is Thursday, March 17th. Happy St. Patty's Day. Today was a great day. I took my IV therapy Kaplan and I passed it with a 76 point something, and that converted to an 89 point 3, I think it was. So that brought my grade up from a 77 to an 80. So I am now passing the class. Our final is next Friday. So we're going over the lecture on Tuesday and Thursday, and then we take our final. And then Monday and Wednesday is our last hospital clinical rotation. So the end of this mod has come very quick. Hopefully I'll pass. I'm feeling more positive now. And we also presented our case studies today on our patients that had cardiac issues. Some of them didn't, which was okay too. And I got a 100. So hopefully that'll bring my grade up a little bit more too. So I'm feeling more positive, hoping that I'm going to pass. I'm feeling pretty good, pretty confident that I will. I wasn't expecting to get such a good grade on my case study, and I did. So great. I'm going to the gym, And I'm going to come home and get some rest since I'm off tomorrow. I plan on cleaning and just enjoying the weather since spring seems like is finally here. Hey guys, it is Monday the 21st of March. I got home from clinical earlier and took a nap because I was just so tired. I'm feeling a little bit under the weather because of the weather changing. But today at clinical was a very successful day. We had a lot going on. We all had new patients. My lady had an external fixation device on her lower left leg, so I took her vitals, asked if she wanted to get ready. She refused because she just wanted to rest. Her leg was killing her. So basically, I got to watch the RN, who specializes in wound care, clean some of her pins and some of her sites, and then she allowed me to do some of them, and then we had to cut new cloth to put around the pin sites, and you cut it like in half kind of so it just fits around, and then we took the rubber little plunger holders and moved them down the pin and put them towards the cloth, kind of up against her skin but not too tight. And then she also had stage 2 ulcer on her foot, which diabetics are prone to getting if they don't take care of their feet properly and comply with the diabetic diet and take care of themselves. So we had to administer a wound vac in that wound, and it was one of the coolest things I've ever assisted with and watched to do. I was very excited. So we basically, the nurse, she cut a black sponge that would fit inside of her heel, and it just kind of sat in there, and then we took a bunch of sticky type of tape, I can't remember what it was called, but basically you seal it to where there's no air, and then you take scissors and clip it and cut it so that you can place the vac on top of it, and then when you cut it on, the suction sucks the sponge, and that's sucking all of the infection and bad stuff out of the wound. So it was very fun to do that. And then I also got to watch and assist with catheter discontinuation. My co-student, one of my classmates, got to do it, and I was there for that. Basically, you take a empty syringe, put it in the port, and you take the plunger and draw back, get all that water out of the balloon to discontinue it, and you tell them to take a deep breath, you know, on three, and then you pull the tubing out. You want to have a towel or a rag, something handy for at the end of the tube in case any urine is left in it. And basically, you just disregard it and throw it out and continue on your way. It's a lot less nerve-wracking discontinuing a catheter instead of inserting one, especially on a male. When I did my first male, it was like, whoa. So, yeah, that's what we did. And then towards the end of the day, after lunch, we had a guy, they checked his sugar. It was really low, like low 20s. And he was unresponsive, so they called MRT, which is medical response team. They started pumping him with a bunch of dextrose and calories because he was refusing to eat for the last couple days, and they kept frequently checking and monitoring his blood sugar, and it went up from 28 to 50, and then by the end of the hour that they were working on him, his blood sugar was over 400 because of all the calories they were pumping into him. And by the time we were wrapping up post-conference, he was coming back around and he was being more responsive and alert. So that's always good that he didn't have to, you know, be transferred to ICU or actually have like a crash cart or anything come to revive him. We didn't have to call code blue. MRT is a step that you go to before code blue is called. So that was all prevented. So our Monday kind of had a quick turnaround at that moment. But it was a great clinical. Wednesday's our last rotation there, and our final is Friday. Hopefully I pass. Hopefully I get to move on to OB and Peds. Hey guys, it is Tuesday, March 22nd. I just got home from lecture. I am beyond exhausted, and this is going to be a long week because I have school and clinical all week this week, and I'm working this weekend, so I don't get to sleep in at all. And today was just really draining, and I couldn't take my two Kaplans today because I didn't have my 6 hours of remediation done, which I don't really care about because you can only read over 70 questions for so long until you just get bored with it, and then they expect us not to just leave the computer up and running to get that remediation time, but if I get the material and I'm ready to retake the test, I don't see why the 6 hours matters. Even if I remediated for just 3 hours, if I understood it in the 3 hours, I should be able to take the test. But whatever, I'll reschedule to take it next mod when it starts next week if I pass this mod. So basically, we reviewed what we went over on, I think it was Thursday of last week. We started talking about how AB positive is a universal recipient for blood. O negative is a universal donor. Anyone can receive it. And fresh frozen plasma. Today we started talking about blood, which is 7 to 10% of the normal body weight, which equals to 5 or 6 liters. Bone marrow is the site of hematopoiesis, which is the formation of blood. And your liver and spleen are like your bone marrow backup. The spleen stores the red blood cells, and the liver is the black backup that helps with clotting factors. The lymphatic system is the common name for the circulatory vessels or ducts in which the fluid bathes the tissues. Lymph is the common name for fluid. Your white blood cells are living cells. Lymph nodes filter out infections and toxic material and destroy it. That's why when you have like strep throat, you can palpate and feel that your tonsils are inflamed or, you know, palpable, because they're trying to fight off that infection. Your spleen filters out foreign body pathogens and stores RBCs. Your red blood cell count carries the oxygen. And the normal range, men is 4.5 to 5.4. Women is 3.6 to 5.0. I'm reading from my handy-dandy notebook because we went over so much today, and after an hour of lecture, my mind just kind of shuts down, and I'm on autopilot just writing everything she says. The erythrocyte index, it aids in describing different types of anemias. The hemoglobin, the normal range is 14 to 6.5 for males. Females is 12 to 15. Hematocrit is the number of packed RBCs found in the blood. And the normal range, male is 40 to 50% and female anywhere 37 to 47%. It can go to 50% for women, but anything higher than that, there's something wrong. The reticulocyte count, those are immature non-nucleated red blood cells, and they don't carry oxygen. Sedimentation rate, they're decreased in sickle cell and congestive heart failure patients. They're increased with people that have Hodgkin's disease or rheumatoid arthritis. Serum ion, also known as IBC, if it's an increased level, it destructs the RBCs, and if it's a decreased level, it indicates anemia. Total iron binding capacity, serum bilirubin. Basically, she wanted us to know that bilirubin is the breakdown of hemoglobin. A skilling test is for vitamin B12. That's when the absorption isn't as good as it should be. So you get that test done to see why you're not absorbing the B12. I love jet noise. Folic acid, also cerium folate level, is also known as one of the B vitamins. And it's B6 for anemia. Wow, America. Gastric analysis is when an NG tube is inserted and they test the gastric contents for pernicious anemia. Lovely. This is what I go through when I try to film like 1,000 times. The Sickledex test, I automatically thought of sickle cell disease, and that's what it's for. It's to test for sickle cell. If someone tests and their hemoglobin has the SS trait, they have the sickle cell disease. If the hemoglobin has a AS trait, it's just the trait. And HGB, the hemoglobin AA, there's no trait and no sickle cell disease. The electroporesis is hemoglobin F, and that can suggest thalassemia. White blood cell count, that's obviously for infection. If it's over 10,000, you're fighting infection. If it's below 5,000, it's going to be hard for you to fight off the infection if you get one. blood culture and sensitivity. It aids in the determination of type of infection, and it's taken prior to giving antibiotics because obviously you want to find out what type of infection it is to give the right type of antibiotic to fight that infection. There's two types of WBCs, granular and agranular. Granular is produced in the bone marrow and consists of the neutrophils, eosinophils, and basinophils, and they're your defense mechanisms. A granular produced in the lymphatic tissue of the spleen. So neutrophils is like bacteria. Basophilic is they release histamine, so like an allergic reaction. And then eosinophils is like parasites. So like, what did she say? Some type of worm. Platelet count, your thrombocytes, the normal range is 150,000 to 400,000. A bone marrow biopsy, that's when they stick a really big needle into your bone and pull marrow out to test it. And if they have a transfusion for that, like a bone marrow transfusion, they're going to have an immediate reaction sometimes. And signs and symptoms of that is chills, rapid pulse, muscle cramps, decreased blood pressure, back pain, chest pain, headache, nausea, vomiting, tingling, numbness, apprehension, and increased urine output. And obviously an allergic reaction is going to be any type of hives, rash, or itching. What else did we talk about? We talked about all of the anemias, the iron deficiency anemia, folic acid anemia, pernicious anemia, which is vitamin B12 deficiency, and that's going to be requiring monthly B12 injections for the rest of their life. Sickle cell anemia is more prone and common in the African American race. What else? Aplastic anemia, also known as hypoplastic, deficiency of the circulatory blood cells. And last ditch effort to like save that is to get a bone marrow transplant with a donor that matches. Thalassemia is a genetic disorder. People of Mediterranean ancestry are at risk for it. It's also known as Cooley's anemia. You can do genetic counseling, blood transfusion, and chelation therapy. I don't even remember her talking about that. Polycythemia is the large amount of RBCs that occurs middle-aged Jewish men. Secondary polycythemia, long-term hypoxia, and it can occur from having COPD. Leukemia is the malignant exacerbation of number of leukocytes. It causes gene damage, and they believe like gasoline, pesticides, and household chemicals and cleaners can contribute to that. There's two types. ALL is acute lymphocytic leukemia, and that's for children. So you can think of like All My Children, the soap opera. That occurs usually, they find out around 3 to 5 years old. And the myelocystic occurs in adults. You have chronic leukemia, which develops over several years, and you can die within 10 years because it's usually fatal. CLL is chronic lymphatic leukemia, and that occurs after age 50, between age 50 and 70, and it affects the B and T lymphocytes. CML is the chronic myelocystic leukemia, 35 to age 50, and you have the Philadelphia chromosome. She didn't really go in depth of that. She just wanted to know like what CML stood for. Signs and symptoms of leukemia is going to be anorexia, fatigue, weight loss, weakness, malaise, hematuria, petechiae, increased temperature, and enlarged lymph nodes. A granulocytosis is the severe low number of cells, and that can include signs and symptoms of headache, fever, chills, fatigue, ulcers, white blood cell count is low, and it can be caused by taking certain medications. Then we went into lymphatic disorders. Lymphedema is swelling of the tissues drained by the lymphatic system caused by the obstruction to flow of the lymph. Hodgkin's disease is malignancy of lymph nodes and the presence of Reed-Sternberg cells in the lymph nodes. That's the number one thing she emphasized for our test coming up on Friday for the final. That's the main thing you look for when you're testing for Hodgkin's or non-Hodgkin's. Non-Hodgkin's lymphoma is more common than Hodgkin's. It's the sixth most common cancer in males and the fifth most common in women. It's more debilitating and it spreads faster than Hodgkin's. And you have enlarged tonsils and adenoids. Treatment You can do radiation, and if it's further staged, you can do radiation and chemo, but that's not always guaranteed for survival. Disseminated intravascular coagulation, aka DIC, you clot, bleed, clot, bleed, clot, bleed. That's what she emphasized that we need to know for the test. And because of the clot and then the bleed and the clot and the bleed, the kidneys don't really know whether to filter or hold on to the nutrients and all the waste and stuff, so usually that results in renal failure. And you can use the medication Amicar to stop the bleeding. Hemophilia, there's class A and class B. Class A is classic hemophilia and it results from the deficiency of factor 8, which is the clotting factor. And then you have B, which is also known as Christmas disease because of the boy with the last name Christmas that it was named after. Males inherit it from the mother. Females inherit the carrier status from their father. You'll have a prolonged PTT but normal bleeding time. And you do not give these people aspirin because they're already at risk for bleeding, so you don't want them to bleed out if they get cut, and you're going to protect them from trauma and use bleeding precautions. Thrombocytopenia, low platelet, since they have a low platelet count, they're going to be at risk for bleeding. Vitamin K, you want to prevent trauma, always use bleeding precautions. And that's pretty much all we talked about, because that's all I wrote. I wrote a lot more, I just don't want this video to be like 100 hours long, because my videos are already long. But I want to go into some detail. My last day for hospital rotations is tomorrow for clinical, and we're all really excited. We hope that we get to do a lot more. And then we're going to review for our final on Thursday, take the final Friday, and hopefully I pass. So it is Thursday, March 24th, I think. My days just run together. I forgot to make a vlog yesterday after clinical. Basically, I was just team leader. I had to make sure that everybody got their vitals done in the morning and in the afternoon. I had to help get all the AccuChecks done at 11. I had to make sure that all the ADLs and patient care was done. I had to hand out nurses' notes and make sure that everybody filled out their nurses' note. And they had to fill out their eval for the facility. And then basically that's all we really did. We went home a little bit early because we didn't have much to do on the floor. They only had a census of like 21 people. So there wasn't very much for us to do. We drew a couple labs and then we discontinued a Foley and that's about it. Today we got out of class literally at like 11 o'clock because all we did was review for our final tomorrow. She's really trying to help people pass this mod and she wanted a thorough review for what we did. We played two games of this game called 20 questions. It's literally just 20 questions. You pick a number and it's a random question. She asks you it and then you answer it. And I wrote down all the questions and answers for those two games. We played Kahoot It. I had never heard of it before this class, and it's an awesome way to study and keep your mind refreshed for certain terms and different subjects. And then we played Jeopardy. We divided the class up half and half, and then that's pretty much it. We just went over things that were going to be on the test. She did tell us specific things that we need to know, like the normal ranges for platelet counts, normal ranges for white blood cell count, and basically, you know, what we need to know for the different anemias and blood transfusions. It seems like it's going to be pretty easy because I know most of the material. There's just a couple of, like, the platelet ranges. I have to remember that. I have to remember, like, the white blood cell count, which is pretty easy because I've said it 100 times today during those games, which is 5 to 10,000. And then there's going to be, like, a scenario with stuff like that. Like, if a patient comes to you and their white blood cell count is less than 5,000, what precautions would you take? And obviously, you're going to want to prevent an infection because their immune system is so low that they wouldn't be able to fight the infection. If it's over 10,000, obviously they're already fighting an infection, so you want to help prevent more infection and then get their blood drawn, see what they're fighting so that you can administer antibiotics. So yeah, our final's tomorrow. Hopefully I pass. I'm kind of stressing out right now because I have an outstanding balance with patient first due to my teeters that were done for school way back when we had to get them done before we went to clinical. my outstanding balance is $300 some, and they were like, can you pay that today? And I was like, no. I've told them 1,000 times that I'm a student and I'm paying you what I can afford. So now I'm trying to find a place to get my PPD done because that's due April 1st, and I can't go to clinical if I don't have a current PPD. So now I'm calling all these places trying to find the cheapest place to go just to get a PPD inserted in my arm and then go back three days later to have it read. It's really not that big of a deal, but they make it a huge deal. So I hope you guys have a great Thursday. I'm ready to take the final. Hopefully I pass it. Hopefully I pass the class. And I'm ready to move on and just become closer to graduating. We have 20 weeks left if I pass this mod. Hey guys, it's Friday, March 25th, and I passed cardiac. I'm so excited. We took our final this morning, and unfortunately I failed it with a 76. You're supposed to get an 80 or above. But because I scored so high on the Kaplan earlier this mod, that kind of pushed me over and kept my head above water. I had an 80.7 this morning, and then after she put our final grade in, my grade dropped down to an 80.35, so I barely skimmed by with the skin of my teeth, but I did pass. I am going on to OB, peds, and lifespan. I also stayed at school after my final to retake 2 Kaplans that I have previously failed. I failed nutrition like 2 mods ago and psych 3 mods ago, I think it was. I took nutrition first, and I thought that I would pass that because I did the remediation. I wrote down notes and really studied vitamin A, K, all that. And the questions that I had previously on the first test weren't even the ones that were up there. But I failed that one again today. I did worse today than I did the first time. I got like a 66 the first time and a 55 today, so that's ridiculous. And then she asked me if I wanted to attempt to take the psych one, and I was like, yeah, sure, I'm here, why not? Passed it with a 72.9, you're supposed to get a 72. So at least I knocked that one out. The new school policy is that you can't have 2 Kaplans hanging over your head before you go to the next mod. You have to sit out. So if I wouldn't have passed that Kaplan today, even though I passed my class today, I would have had to sit out until I pass those Kaplans, and you have to wait like 2 weeks after, and you have to do all the remediation, and it was just crazy. But today was a good Friday. I passed cardiac. I'm moving on to obstetrics, peds, and lifespan, like I said. It's just been such a long mod. I'm sorry that this video is so long, but I tried to be as informational as possible without dragging it out. Because we learned a lot this mod. This is the first mod throughout the whole program that I've ever filled almost a whole notebook full of notes. Like, we were constantly taking notes, constantly taking quizzes, the tests. The first test was the hardest. Today's final, it wasn't hard. I knew most of the material. And that's something I want to say. If you're taking quizzes and tests and you're failing, and, you know, when you fail, you kind of lose hope. Don't lose hope. Keep the faith. Believe in yourself. People learn differently. You might need to go back and try to grasp the concept different than other people. Some people, like during lecture, will just pick up all the content that the teacher is talking about. And I'm like, how did you learn that already? I haven't even wrote that down in my notes. Like, I have to write things out, and then I visually retain it in my head so that I see myself writing it when I think of it once I hear that term or that phrase again. So everyone learns differently. You just have to find the approach that works best for you. If you fail, which I have done in the past, I barely passed today and I really thought I was going to fail, you really just have to pick up where you left off and keep going. You have to look at this failure as another approach to succeed. You already took the class, so you know what to expect. You have to just keep looking over your notes, maybe take notes differently this time, record, take pictures of the slideshows, whatever you have to do to try and pass. It's easy for you because you're already going to know most of the material. The only thing is your teacher might toss up the way she tests or quizzes, which is what they do at my school every mod. So you can do it. You just have to have faith in yourself. You have to believe in yourself. You have to find ways to motivate yourself. My motivation right now, 20 weeks left of school. Like, August is right around the corner. It's getting warm out. Everyone's getting senioritis because we're all the way up in the 200 level courses. We're all very excited. So, if you guys have any questions or comments, please feel free to leave them as always, and I will see you guys next mod.